रुचिका गुप्ता, आई एम द सीईओ ऑफ द एप हेल्थ क्लिक अवे। वेलकम टू द हेल्दी कम्युनिटी ऑफ हेल्थ क्लिक अवे। आई वुड लाइक टू विश ऑल ऑफ आवर इंडियन व्यूअर्स हैप्पी इंडिपेंडेंस डे। इट्स बीन ऑलमोस्ट 2 वीक्स सिंस वी हैव लॉन्च द हेल्थ क्लिक अवे कोच ऐप। सिंस देन वी आर रिसीविंग एन ओवरवेलमिंग रिस्पॉन्स। आर कोचेज आर ऑलरेडी हेल्पिंग हेल्थ क्लिक अवे यूजर्स टू एम्बार्क ऑन अ सस्टेनेबल हेल्थ जर्नी। Now you don't have to be a celebrity or need a lot of money to hire a personal coach. Our aim is to help the community at large to stay fit and live a healthy lifestyle. Make your health journey more joyful. Download and start using the app Health Click Away for free. As we all know, some areas of health and fitness are full of misinformation. So it's not surprising that some things get overlapped with emotional beliefs. To help you separate facts from fiction, today we have with us HCPC registered dietitian Ms. Raman Preet from London. She will help us understand some of the most common myths about health and the facts behind them. Hi, Raman.
Hi, thank you so much for having me back.
Surely, it's our pleasure. This is our second live on this topic. If you wish to look at the previous live session on bursting health myths, do visit Health Click Away YouTube channel. Now to start off with, Raman, I wanted to remind our viewers about the feature of a Health Click Away user app. It allows you to calculate the calories you need per day to lose weight in a healthy way, as well as track how many calories you have consumed along with the macronutrients. Let's start with our first question. Raman, tell our users, which oil should they use? Should they use olive oil for cooking or not?
Yeah, that's a really good question as always. And I'm so glad to hear that people are finding these useful as well. So In terms of oils, at the moment, the government guideline still recommends sort of using a polyunsaturated oil. So an example of that could be rapeseed oil, which is essentially just vegetable oil. And it's actually one of the cheapest oils on the market as well. So if you were to kind of look, you know, into kind of trying to use oil in your cooking or whatever, then the government guidelines does recommend rapeseed oil, which, as I say, is the cheapest. I think what's important is that olive oil is very, very healthy for you. However, when you cook it, because of the heat, it actually changes its structure. And once its structure is changed, it has a different impact on your body. So if you were to include olive oil in your diet, which I think is a great addition, it's a very healthy addition, I would recommend trying to include it in a raw format rather than it being cooked. So perhaps a teaspoon or something in your hummus or on salad that you're having as a dressing can be a great way to incorporate it. I think, as always, I'd remind our, you know, viewers that moderation is key. So right. Even though olive oil is very, very healthy, it is also very calorific because it is a fat. It belongs to the fat macronutrient. So I think keeping it in moderation and having it as part of a healthy balanced diet would be a great way to, you know, try and get some unsaturated, polyunsaturated fat in your diet, which is very good for your heart.
Thank you. Thank you for answering that question. Okay. So let's answer this question. I think, and most of the people are believing on this statement, but you just tell, is it right or wrong? Starving yourself can be effective for weight loss.
Very interesting. And I think right. This question links very nicely to, you know, one of the features of the app, Health Click Away. The app helps to calculate how many calories you need. And it helps to calculate how many calories you're consuming. Now, the word starving yourself, it suggests that you're not eating very much or you're eating a very limited amount. From our previous sessions together, we know that essentially weight loss is about energy in and energy out and the balance between it. It's just a numbers game, right? So if you are going into an energy deficit, now whether you do that in a healthy way, where you're trying to minus, you know, a sensible amount of calories from your current diet, or whether you go to this extreme of, or, you know, starving yourself and maybe consuming only 300, 400, 500 calories per day, which would kind of be classified as starvation, then you again are in deficit, so you will lose weight. but it may not be effective because as soon as you go back to your normal diet, you will start to gain the weight back and probably more. And what you'll find is that because you're not eating very much, your body will start to deplete of its nutrients, so its micronutrients. So things like water-soluble vitamins, which are like vitamin C, is an example, and the B vitamins are an example of water-soluble. We don't store that in our body for very long, so they tend to pass through our urine quite quickly. Whereas compared to some of our fat-soluble vitamins, so that's vitamin D is included in that, they tend to stay in the body for a lot longer periods of time. So if you were to go on sort of a, you know, like an extreme diet that meant that you were really limiting what you eat, you wouldn't necessarily deplete yourself of the fat-soluble vitamins, but you would definitely, depending on how long you do it for, would deplete yourself of the water-soluble vitamins. So again, you know, these kind of diets, and we touched on it with sort of fad diets in our last sessions as well, that it can be quite dangerous because you can become right. deficient in some vitamins. And it's the same with this one as well, that if you were to go to this extreme, yes, you might lose weight, but it wouldn't be a healthy way to do it because you might find that you become deficient in vitamin C. You find that you might become deficient in some other minerals and vitamins and things like that. And it's just not a great way. And also just for your metabolism as well, to lose weight that quickly in that period of time is not healthy either.
Right. And I think here we can mention that the app will help you doing that in a healthy way and sustainable way, where they can track whatever they're eating and along with the macronutrients. So there should not be any malnutrition or any kind of problem they'll be facing regarding health.
Absolutely. Exactly. And because the app helps to track your weight as well, that you can see on there if you tend to lose weight very quickly, because again, that can be a sign that, you know, perhaps you need to not do it as quickly and rapidly because it can deplete your body. So again, the app can be really useful for that.
Yes. Next question. Energy drink contains specific alertness boosting ingredients. Is that right?
This is quite interesting, and I think a lot of students out there are probably, you know, they drink a lot of energy drinks, and perhaps people, you know, with sort of stressful jobs as well, in this kind of world, hectic world that we're living in, not to name a few, but some of them, you know, they say it gives you wings, you start to fly. So yes. So as far as I'm aware, there's nothing special in these drinks. What tends to give you the alertness is a really high caffeine content. So what it does is it gives you a similar effect if you were to have coffee or tea, but the difference between tea or coffee is, whereas the caffeine may be, you know, one or two level, in these energy drinks would be sort of 9 to 10 level. And this is one okay. of the reasons we definitely don't recommend children having energy drinks, because caffeine, it has a chemical in there that can bind to certain vitamins and minerals. So it's really important that children are sort of kept away from teas, coffees, and energy drinks, because they need those vitamins and minerals more than us, you know, because they're growing. Right. So it's important that they're kept away as to allow the best absorption of these vitamins and minerals. And most kids, you know, tend to be sort of fussy eaters, and it's hard to get enough kind of healthy, nutritious stuff.
Exactly.
Full of, you know, vegetables and things like that. So anything that kind of takes away from their ability to absorb, we would, you know, recommend sort of parents to keep them away. Caffeine is one of them. So there's nothing really special about these energy drinks. All they tend to do is they just have a very high caffeine content, which helps to make you feel very alert. We know that caffeine makes your senses sharper, your reaction time increases. And that's actually one of the reasons that athletes, if you don't have caffeine very often, and then when you do have it, we know that it can have a significant improvement in your reaction time. So if you're going for, you know, like a, if for example, you're going to do a marathon or something, it's not a bad idea to potentially, you know, have some caffeine right before you do it, but not during your training time, because then you'll have the best impact of it because your body's not so used to it. Or perhaps not a marathon, but if perhaps you were doing a sprint or something, or a shorter run, in a marathon, you might find that you might need to take it more often, or you become a bit, because caffeine's also a diuretic as well. It makes you want to go to the toilet. So if you're running a marathon, you might not want that. But It can be useful when you're doing sort of sports and you've got a game coming up or something to try and just push you over the edge a little bit.
Yeah, agree with you. So let's break this myth. Eating frequently meals boosts metabolism.
Yeah, great question. So I think I would probably strip this question back to understanding what metabolism really is. I think people still really struggle with this word. And I think, last time we spoke about the word diet and how it's become synonymous with sort of trying to lose weight and cutting down on food, where it just means what you eat. So in terms of metabolism, it also just means the sort of breaking down and the building of our body and all the chemical reactions that happen between that. So metabolism has become synonymous with sort of, how much energy we burn. And it is to an extent true like that, but it's all about the chemical reactions that are happening. So when we're eating, so for example, we've just had a meal and let's say there was a bit of protein, bit of carbohydrates, bit of fat in that meal, because as we know in nature, no food is completely one group. It contains a little bit of the others. You have a meal with all three. Your body, in order to absorb it, will convert proteins into amino acids, carbohydrates into simpler sugars, and fats into fatty acids. So lipids will turn into fatty acids. So it will break it down, right? So essentially, the way I can explain it is, it's the opposite of IKEA. So in IKEA, you get your furniture all broken down and you come home and you build it up. Whereas this is the opposite. So now you're moving house. So you need to like break everything down because you've eaten this big meal, it's gone to your tummy, and now you need to get the nutrients all around your body. So it's breaking it down and then it's transporting it all over. And the reason that metabolism is increased when you eat is because your body's taking energy to break all that food down. But what people tend to miss is that when you're consuming food, yes, your metabolism will increase, but you're also gaining the calories from eating as well, because the food, of course, will contain energy. So yes, you're using calories in order to burn the food, in order to kind of break it down, but you're also gained however many calories from the meal. And it's not quite the same. So if you eat a 500 calorie meal, you might only use maybe 50 calories in order to kind of, break it down. So yes, it does boost your metabolism, but it's not a way to lose weight. You'll never be able to catch up in order to lose weight that way. There is some evidence to say that certain foods can increase the metabolism. So for example, having some spicy foods with sort of chili, peppers, things like that are said to increase your metabolism a little bit. So if you're trying to lose weight, it might be an idea to maybe try and include a little bit of that, but it probably won't make that much of a difference. Ultimately, it's all about moderation and increasing your activity.
It's going to help in the long run, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so next question is, supplements can help you lose weight. Is it right?
Yeah, really good question. So I think it's probably looking at which supplements can sort of help you. So some supplements are out there which are marketed as sort of, a weight loss pill. Magic pills, exactly. some of them you can actually get as prescribed, at least here in the UK. You can speak to your GP, your doctor regarding it, and you can potentially get them prescribed. They can be effective. They can be effective to lose between 2 to 5 kilos, which for some people is significant. It could be 5 to 10% of your body weight, depending on how much you weigh. So which is a significant amount of weight that you could lose. The problem with them is generally they target fat. So what they do is you cannot just take these pills and expect to lose weight. Normally you need to make changes in your diet anyway. And one of the changes that the generally speaking, the pills recommend is having a low fat diet. Now, if we remember from last time, we know that fat actually has the highest amount of calories per 1 gram. So in 1 gram of fat, there's 9 calories. Compared to carbohydrates or protein, where there's just 4. So if you're having a lower fat content, generally speaking, you're going to reduce your calories anyway, because in just the same amount, you're having a bit less. So you're doing that already. But on top of that, what actually happens is when you take these pills with your meals, the pills bind to the fat and it doesn't allow your body to actually absorb it. So you actually pass it through your body in your bowels. Unfortunately, what that can mean is you have a lot of gastric symptoms. So you tend to have really, if I can be graphic, if people aren't eating at home, I hope, really fatty stools, which can be really uncomfortable for a lot of people. And it can produce, you know, lots of gastric symptoms, tummy symptoms. Some people get bloating, abdominal pain, things like that. So these medications, yes, they can help you lose weight, but they should still be treated like medication. They do have side effects, and it doesn't work for everyone. And if one time you did forget, you know, if you didn't realize how much fat was in your meal, if you were eating out or something, they can have really kind of uncomfortable side effects to them as well. So it's not really anything we tend to recommend. And as I always say, you know, once you get off them and you go back to your normal diet, you're going to, most likely you're going to gain the weight back. You know, unfortunately, you know, a lot of people think that, oh, you know, they have this kind of image in their head of, okay, you know, when I'm 50 kilos or when I'm 60 kilos,
I'm fine.
Yeah. I'll never have to think about food ever again. Exactly. I'll never have to worry about dieting ever again. Unfortunately, that just isn't the case. You know, that's probably the biggest myth out there. If you are any age, any, you know, man, woman, whatever, you have to always consider this energy balance. And regardless of who you are, you're always going to need to think about what you're eating to try and be the healthier you, and in order to maintain your weight as well. Because when you start to think, oh, I can eat anything now, I'm this great weight, what will happen is you'll start to gain the weight back. Because you'll start eating all these sweet things and all these really fatty things. And before you know it, you're, you know, that deficit is going to turn into an increase and you'll be having more calories than you're burning and you'll start to gain the weight back. So
yeah,
I think changing your
lifestyle.
Yeah, absolutely. Your lifestyle, your day-to-day diet that suits you, so then you can carry it over a long term, is the way to go. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
So basically the aim of this app, why we created this, because everybody, we don't know about what these calories, macronutrients and all this, and they don't know how to calculate it and how to read it. So this app will teach them, or maybe tell them the basics of these things, so that in their daily lives, without doing any changes or drastic changes or eating anything different from whatever they are eating, this app will help them lose weight or maintain their healthy weights naturally. Whatever they are eating, let them enjoy their food and still they can maintain that healthy healthy lifestyle. Because this, if they follow the calorie goal, whatever the budget, calorie budget for the day, they'll be able to stay within the limit.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Exactly. And if you know that you're going to, you know, there's a Independence Day celebration and you're going to be having lots of samosas and rasgulai and gulab jamun, then you know, okay, I have this much budget, as you say, then I need to just have a lighter breakfast, for example. And then you can enjoy that without feeling guilty. So absolutely.
And one best thing I feel with this app is, like earlier, I used to feel guilty that I'm eating this fatty food, and even if I'm eating it, I'm not enjoying, because I'm getting the feeling of guilt along with eating the food. But now I know that how much this thing, this product has calorie. Even if I don't know, I just put it in the app. It will tell me you have consumed this much. Now I'm mindful that next time I eat these things. And then I'm aware that whatever I'm eating is for my benefit or not. Next time I'll make choices accordingly. Instead of eating two burgers, maybe I'll eat one. Or maybe I'll replace some few things. That I'm accountable for my own health.
Absolutely.
If a doctor is saying you do this, do this, do this, then you will follow it. But that's when you have taken that step ahead, that you go to doctor and take the consultation. But if it's sitting at home and you want to do changes in your lifestyle at your own, just I really appreciate people to use the app. Because it's all natural. You need not to take any magic pills, or you need not to do starvation, or you need not to crave yourself for anything. You can enjoy whatever you are eating, you are cooking at your home or buying from markets, and still you can maintain a healthy lifestyle. right, Raman?
Absolutely. And again, a great thing about the app is that all the kind of ethnic foods and the traditional foods that it has, I think so often we don't know how many calories something has, or
exactly,
you know, how heavy it is in terms of calories, because it's easy on a packet food. You know, you get like cereal and you can look on the back of it and you can find out. But if you're making a paratha,
any recipe,
and it's really difficult to try and estimate, okay, how much is this, you know, how many calories are in there, you know, what am I doing? And it's great with this app to be able to just kind of log it in, you know, don't have to think about it and it's done and you know exactly, all right. So I've had, you know, one roti, for example, and it's 150 calories or 200 calories. So it's perfect.
I think this is the best part, and this app is getting popularity because of this thing that it has a possibility that you can create your own recipe. Like if I'm cooking something, it doesn't mean that you are cooking the same thing. So in order to calculate your food, your calories, how much you are exactly you are eating, because you cannot, if you are eating 50, you don't want to put 100 because then your budget will be, you know, shaky. So in order to put whatever you are eating, you can create your own recipe. It has all the ingredients and you can create your recipe to calculate, because whatever you are cooking, it means you are cooking that thing on a regular basis at your home. So you can create the recipe and you can use n number of times. And if other people are using, like somebody who is using the app, if they want to use it, you will earn the rewards for that usage. So anybody can create their recipe and people let people enjoy. And I'm even getting the feedback that these recipes are really healthy and easy to make, because these all recipes are like regular food. We are not doing anything special, because it's not the platform where you are providing recipes to your viewers. No, it's whatever we are eating. We are putting the recipes to calculate calories for us. So if you like, you are more than welcome to use the recipes, or you can create your own recipes to calculate exact calorie intake.
And that's fantastic, because I think, you know, just going off of that, again, for so long, people used to think, oh, when I'm trying to lose weight, I need to make something separate for myself and something separate for my family. And again, that's, you know, so not true. Now, as you say, you've got this recipe, you know exactly, right, if I've made some lentils or I've made lasagna, I know I can just have this much, this portion size, and that will be. And then there's no double cooking, there's no kind of worrying I'm overdoing it or anything like that. So absolutely, it's fantastic.
And sometimes people ask me, like, provide me the diet plan. But, you know, that is a mindset where you want that stick, or you have the you have the feeling of the spoon feeding. But here, once you are provided the diet plan, after a week, you will think that, oh, it's too much work for us. We have to prepare food according to the diet plan or prescribe things. But here we are providing you the opportunity to reconnect with your own food, whatever you are cooking at your home for your family, or whatever you are eating if you are going outside with your family. You need not to change your taste buds according to the diet plan. You can eat whatever you want to, still you can maintain a healthy lifestyle. So that's the best part here, that we are not providing a diet plan. If you as a user is putting their recipes or putting their food, they're logging in, they're fine.
Yeah. And that's fantastic.
Yeah. Thank you. So next question is, which oil is best for cooking? You just said it's the grapeseed oil, right?
Yeah. The grapeseed oil. Yeah.
Yeah. So which vegetable chips are basically like eating vegetables. Is it right?
Yeah, this is quite interesting, especially with the pop-up of sort of healthy foods in the market. You know, you can buy kale chips now and people think, oh, I'm sort of getting my nutrients.
Healthy.
Yeah, I would say that, yes, definitely sort of vegetable chips are probably healthier than sort of potato chips, because potatoes, even though they technically are a vegetable, they count more in the category of sort of rice and flour. So they're your sort of starchy carbohydrates. So in terms of vegetables, yes, if you were to, for example, bake some, you know, sweet potatoes or something in the oven and have that, that's a great sort of way of getting one of your five a day, you know, your one of your five a day fruit or vegetables, and trying to eat it in a sort of tasty way as well. I think the worry is that people become too heavily reliant on this, and especially if it's shop bought, you might not know what kind of other additives and things are being added to it. So salt is a really big thing, and I don't think we've spoken about it, so perhaps we can maybe focus on it in a different session. But salt is a really big contributor to heart health, especially for South Asians, as a large percentage of us tend to suffer from high blood pressure. So it's really important that when we are sort of buying these chips and things in the shop, we have a look at the salt content. Again, they tend to be, if you're buying from the shop, you know, they tend to be really high in saturated fats, which also isn't good for your heart. But I think everything in moderation, you know, as we say, that once in a while is absolutely fine. But, you know, trying also to include vegetables that you've cooked yourself, you know, ideally sort of steamed, is a great way. The one thing I would say that we haven't touched on in this question, but just to add in that, you know, sometimes people think boiling vegetables is a really healthy way. I think the only thing to consider is that when you do boil vegetables, a lot of the vitamins actually leach into the water, and then we tend to throw the water away and just eat the vegetables. So you've actually lost all the kind of vitamins in there. So steaming is a better way. Or, of course, broil is probably the best, but steaming is a good way. If you are sort of going to boil vegetables, then it's better to turn it sort of into a soup. So then you have the water along with
it. Everything. Yes.
Absolutely. Rather than, you know, just kind of throwing it away because it has all the nutrients. And also leaving the skin on is a great way to increase your kind of vitamins as well. So if you're having some potatoes, you know, try and leave the skin on the potatoes. It's a good way, sort of whatever you're having, even if you're
like
having
cucumber, zucchini.
Absolutely. Apples, pears, all that sort of stuff. But of course, you know, don't go extreme, not bananas or, or oranges. You don't have to have skin in that.
Use your brain also.
Yeah. But a lot of the times you can have, you know, the skin, which is great.
Yeah. So next is, do you think skipping breakfast makes you fat?
Yeah, I think for a long time, I know that when I did my degree as well, that we used to recommend having three main meals a day and having three snacks in between. And the reason for this is a lot of people, what they don't realize is when they're skipping meals, yes, they're not sitting down to eat a meal, but they actually tend to eat more in snacks because they're hungry. So they're picking on things and they're eating and they're snacking and they're not realizing. And especially, you know, guys that do the cooking for the house, they're in the kitchen, you know, and it's so easy while you're cooking something to kind of nibble on things. And it all adds up. All the calories do add up, you know, everything. Yeah. You know, if your kids are having a bit of popcorn and you just quickly go in and grab a handful, that does add up. If they're having crisps and you have a little bit, it adds up. So the reason that we don't recommend necessarily skipping breakfast is because if you tend to skip breakfast, you're more likely to snack. And when you are hungry, you're more likely to reach for really high fatty and sugary foods because we're programmed that way. You know, if you look back at when we were cavemen and women, you know, we were drawn to foods that were really high in fat and really high in sugar because we needed that for our survival. And so we are programmed to want these things, especially when we're not feeling our best. So it's in a way, I wouldn't say to someone who isn't used to having breakfast to start having breakfast. But I also wouldn't say to someone who wants to lose weight to start skipping breakfast either, because what they might find is that if they were having breakfast, they didn't eat anything until 12. Now that they're not having breakfast, they might start sort of snacking on things, which increases their sort of calorie intake anyway.
Yes, totally agree with you. Thank you so very much, Raman. I have lots many questions, but you know, the time is running. It's always a pleasure talking to you and getting answers of all our questions. And I think users can learn a lot from this and can maintain a healthy lifestyle. And I would encourage them to use the app. And if they think that the information is useful, I would like them to share with their friends and family to help others to maintain a healthy lifestyle.
That's great. Thank you
so much. Take care. Take care, and hopefully we'll see you in the next live.
Absolutely.
Take care. Bye-bye.